Kent's daughter is going to finish her senior year online or at CSM, so we no longer have a vice president. So we are going to be taking nominations for that. We're going to put something out too, so I don't expect both of you to do it. But if you would consider or think about it, and we're also going to be taking, I'm going to be leaving this year. This is my last year. My daughter's a senior. So we're going to be having the president spot available, and Tiara just got orders. She's going to Kenya. She's in the Air Force. So she's going to be leaving in April. So we're going to have an open board. So we're going to need people to step up. I'm going to put something out in the next Lackey Lookout, letting people know that, you know, we need officers. So if you are interested, you know, please start thinking about it. That way we can train you and help guide before we leave. So we'll take the nominees, and then we'll probably vote, hopefully at our next meeting, and try to get some other people to step in. I'd hate to see what we started go to the wayside. So I hope that people would consider thinking about it. I know a lot of people help out with the boosters. I wish we could pull a few of those friends over this way too, because we support the entire school, the staff and the students with the PTSO. These are all our voting members that I had registered to vote that paid, that are listed here on the agenda. Financial report, it shows all the balances, our beginning, our ending balance as of 10/28, and that was our last meeting. And then our expenses since then were $2,242.97. Most of that was spiritware. We restocked and repurchased spiritware. We also have to pay sales tax when we sell that. So our financial secretary here at the school, she takes care of that for us. And then I did do the pies for the teachers in November. I went and bought little mini pies, so every teacher got a little pie and a little thank you card from the PTSO. So, and Ms. Perillo was very generous to pass this out, because I'm a teacher myself, so I can't be here at this school when I'm at my other school. So, revenue, these are spiritware sales. This is what we brought in at all the dates that we sold. Most of those were varsity football games, and one of the dates was the very beginning was the orientation nights. And then we did get a refund. Mrs. Miller sent me the spreadsheet before I left, so we had a refund of $4.82 of sales tax that came back to us for some reason. I guess we paid too much. And the last deposit I put in was just January 3rd of $70, because Miss Nikki Watkins sells spiritware in the school store for us. Our spiritware is basically our biggest fundraiser. That's where we make the most money, and it gives the kids here an opportunity to have spiritware, because before we started this a couple years ago, the sports did their own thing, but there wasn't anything general. So we started the general spiritware, so it's for everybody to be able to purchase. And a lot of the kids that do sports purchase it as well, and their families. Dues, we collected $60. Total deposits were $2,984.82, and our current balance is $4,092.88 as of today. That's based on the spreadsheet. And I have the spreadsheet that Ms. Miller, our financial secretary, keeps with everything on it. So if anybody needs to see all the details, we have all of that. We had a lot more incoming than outgoing this year. We've only had, besides the sales tax, we only had three outgoing expenses, which was spiritware and the pies. So we haven't spent any other money as far as that. For upcoming fundraisers, last year we did the Valentine Carnation Grams. We're going to be doing that again. I'll send out all the information. I got posters already printed out. We're going to hang up. That will start January 13th. We'll sell through the 17th. Parents can buy for their children. Children can buy for children. Staff can buy for staff. Whoever wants to buy, the more the merrier. And we will email the flyer home. It'll go through Mrs. Perillo with her Lackey Lookout and whatever other things that they send out via email. We don't send paper copies home with the children, because they would not get home probably anyways. Plus, we're a green school, so we try to save as much as possible. They will be for sale at the school store, and Ms. Watkins is very generous in her time and selling things for us as well. So she will take orders on Wednesdays and Fridays during charger time. That's when the school store is open. We do have a Chipotle night. I had to go online and sign up. It's kind of like a random thing. You sign up and you see if you get it. And we did get approved for March 23rd from 4 to 8. With Chipotle, you have to have at least $300 in sales before you can get any of the money. And then after that, you get 33%. So we will send flyers out. I will have Ms. Alvarez text out the flyer and everything. So invite your families, share it on social media. We'll start putting it out there, because the more the merrier. Like I said, the more we can bring in, because that's basically easy money for us. We don't have to do anything. Just go there and eat. And that helps support money so we can buy things for the school and for Teacher Appreciation Week. I am going to set up, try to set up one for Foster's Grill. I spoke to the gentleman there, and I'm waiting on a date. These are for April, one of these dates, so I'm just waiting to see which one they'll approve for us. That would be another dinner night out with your family. But as I said, we're at their mercy. We have to wait to see what date they will give us, because other groups and organizations do the same thing. For spirit wear, I had a lot of interest in baseball caps. I've had parents ask, men mostly, but I did, we ordered the beanies, which sold very well. We only have less than half of those left. So I went in through all four promos, which we used before, and was very pleased with their quality. And I have an order right now waiting to be approved for baseball caps, so we would be able to get, and they're a nice cap. It's not a cheap, they're a decent cap. They're not the all-fit ones, you know, the really, really expensive ones, but they're decent. There's a black one with a little white in the rim, and there's a royal blue with the white in the rim. So it would have the logo on the front, and they can't put wording because it's such a small space, so I want the logo big so you can see it, otherwise they make it smaller. And then on the back of the hat, it'll say Lackey. It's all embroidered. So it's stitching. So we would get an order of black and blue. That way we'd have a variety to sell. Our cost is $7 and I think it was 68 cents per hat. And then we usually mark them up, or $7.64 per hat. And usually we mark them up between $5 to $6 to make our profit. So, and then we can sell those at the sporting events, especially with spring coming up, baseball, softball coming up, and then being outside, people like to wear hats and stuff. I've had some people ask for visors, but only one or two people. I don't think visors would be as good as the hats. So so I'd like to vote on that tonight, if we can, to approve the purchase them for $389.39. Most of our spirit wear sells, so we probably will recoup that back pretty quickly. And then we'll have them for whatever's left will be for next year. They can sell next year. So, and that's it for that. So we can take a vote for that. Anybody want to second the vote for the spirit?
Or do we have to nominate the people?
No, I don't think we have to nominate.
I second it.
Okay, all in favor of ordering this, the hats for $389.39?
Aye.
Okay, so we will have the hats ordered and hopefully have them here in about 2 weeks. That way we'll have them for spring and hopefully the end of the winter season too. I know some of the coaches have been asking me. They've been chomping at the bit. So that's basically all I have. Carla, you missed out. We have a lot of officers leaving, and Carla will be leaving as well. She's our PAC representative for the Parent Association. She goes to the board meetings, or the special meeting, right? It's a special meeting just for
you. Yeah.
And
Parent Advisory Committee.
And then she reports back what the board has to say for us. And her daughter's a senior too, so her baby's graduating too. So I know. We only have one person stay. That's it.
I know
we said
I'm staying.
Please stay. We need to pull some people over from Boosters and try to convince them. I mean, it's not very difficult, so to come in and help out. So, anything new, any questions or anything that you guys have? Yes.
Yeah, unfortunately. This is my first time coming to this meeting, and my daughter's in school as well. She's first year, so 10th grader. So, I have no idea what this is. That's why I wanted to come to know what is it all about.
Well, we are here to support the staff and teachers. We raise money, we fundraise for the school. So, like when they need academic letters for the children or certificates, we provide money for that. We also, if a teacher needs something, like if they need something for their classroom and Ms. Brillo can't, you know, the budget's not there, they can come to us and we can donate money for supplies or things that they need. We've had students come to us in the past that were like trying to do different academic things and they needed sponsorships. So they would ask for money to help sponsor them, so we can sponsor up to a certain amount of money, you know, for things like that. And we also do teacher appreciation for the teachers that week. We try to give them something back, like a luncheon or the staff, something little to just thank them for all that they do for the kids.
And
so,
don't we put on the homecoming dance and prom?
Well, no, we don't do that. That's through the school.
Okay.
No, that's not PTSO. None of that is. They have not come. I mean, there's a form. So like a teacher or somebody needs to request money for something, there's a form that they fill out and they turn it in to us, and then we vote on it, like how much we can give them out of our funds to help support whatever they ask for. So, and I haven't seen any forms lately, so
I have it for my principal's report.
Oh, do you? Mm-hmm. Okay. So that's the only thing that, and then also we pay for PBIS. We help fund the awards for the kids. Ms. Perla does the PBIS, it's the Positive Behavioral Incentives. So every quarter she rewards the kids that earn PBIS, and we help pay for those donuts and juice or whatever she gives them. So we help support that as well. So, but it's harder. I know, like, I'm an elementary teacher, so our PTO, when you go to their meetings, there's a lot of people there usually, because when you're younger, it's harder in the high school to get parents in. But the more we can get in, the more people we can get in here to help, it would be better for the staff and students as well. So we get busy though, I understand. All right, if there's nothing else, I'll use this one.
Okay. We have a couple items here for the principal's report. And a couple of them are kind of follow-ups to our previous meeting. The first thing I have on here, and I have to add two items too, because of I did have a request for funding from the counseling department to help pay for certificates and awards and so forth. So I'll add that at the end. The first thing is something called the STAR ratings. So also to piggyback on what Ms. Furman said, what is, you know, part of this organization is we meet every other month, and it's also an opportunity for parents. If they have questions or they have ideas or questions or something about initiatives for the school, it's really about what can we do to help for school improvement, okay? So, you know, part of it is fundraising, but a lot of it is too is what can we do as a school to always make our school better. So I hope that helps you as well. So, you know, there's a new system for schools in which we receive ratings, okay? And last year, you got a message from me about how we were a 4-star school. You can be a 1, a 2, a 3, a 4, or a 5. And it was very new. We didn't know much about it. And we're still a little bit foggy, you know, about the whole rating, because each year there seems to be like a new component that is added. So last year we were a 4, which we made it barely. You needed a 60 to be a 4. And that's exactly what we had, was a 60. So there's a lot of different components to give you a star rating. Some of it is the achievement of the results of the PARC exams, which would be in English and in algebra. Attendance is a component. It's your curriculum. It's access for special needs students and programs that they can be involved in and so forth. There's also a component for surveys, where students and educators take surveys, kind of based on perception. So, you know, we originally had a 4-star rating. This year we are 3. And I'll start with the highlights, and I'll talk about where there's room for improvement. We made a tremendous gain in English this year. That is where we had always struggled. In the past, our math scores were always very stellar, and we always seemed to struggle in English, especially with writing, because students just really do not like to write. It's the test that they take. It was formerly called PARC, and now it's called MCAP, okay? And what we find, and this is a piece, you know, what I'm sharing in terms of my experience as a principal, as a teacher, as a parent, as everything. This is my 31st year, all in Charles County Public Schools, and students really don't like to write because they spend most of their time on this device. Well, I don't know about you, but you can't do a lot of formal writing on this. Mm-hmm. And the test, the is about writing. It's higher level thinking. It is, there's a lot of questions where you have to answer them. And there could be two right answers, but what is the best when you select an answer? I guess, would you say, Ms. Alvarez, do you agree with that one? Also, in writing, again, it's not about being right or wrong in your writing. It's how you defend your thesis statement in the writing prompt or whatever. So it's something that we've kind of struggled with here at the school. And then we got our results back, and our current juniors, okay, who were sophomores last year, did stellar. I saw so many fives, and I remember Ms. Alvarez was part of
yes.
it when we got the data, and we were just so excited to see these scores. They were just amazing. But then, on the other hand, our algebra tanked. And not just us. It was a state problem. It was the state of Maryland. It was Charles County. Everyone plummeted. All the high schools. So we don't know. We look. We talk to our math department. We talk to our math teachers. You know, we try to drill down what happened here. And we really don't know. I can't. You know, our math department feels that a lot of times the students coming from middle school lack the requisite skills that are needed to algebra one, to keep that fast paced curriculum, that they have to spend a lot of time reteaching, and sometimes they are not able to move fluently through the curriculum. So we kind of knew that we were gonna maybe move down, because the goal every year is to move up. We have goals, targets that we need to meet. And then we had gotten closer in English, we dropped in math, so it was like, oh my goodness. So we thought it could maybe possibly equal out a little bit, but we knew by math taking a decrease that we would lose some of our points. So we went from a 60 to like a 56.4. So we lost about 3 percentage points in our scores. Another piece that was new to add to our rating from the previous year is a survey component. And your children take surveys by the state. And our educators, our staff, takes the surveys. The one group that doesn't take it would be new teachers, first year teachers, because they were not in the building. Another group that does not take it would be myself and the administrative team. We are not allowed to take it. So we do not know what it looks like. However, what we've been told just from staff is that a lot of the questions are kind of like perception. Do you think, you know, do you think this percentage of students do this? Do you think this percentage of students do this? And so these surveys got added in this year. And there was no right or wrong. It was just like, what is your perception? And in 12 schools in the county, us being one of them, you know, 12 of us went from like a 4-star to a 3-star school. So we're not the only school that happened to. And the others maintained. But we found that the surveys did not do justice for any of the schools. It just actually brought the scores down. And so we really weren't sure about, you know, what are these questions? And I don't know, because I can't fix something that I'm not privy to seeing. So we did receive some standards from the Office of Accountability about it. And one category in particular that seemed to be low across all levels, elementary, middle, and high, was the category about student substance abuse. So we actually, at a high school level, scored higher and scored better about substance abuse of students than some of the elementary schools did. So that's why we were like, the elementary principals were like, well, you know, we could understand maybe at a high school you could see an increase, or middle, you know, you elementary should be here, middle would be here, and high would be here. So that's why we do have some confusion about it. So we don't have all the answers, you know, about it, but it's something that we are looking into. So, you know, I'm not happy that we lost 3 points, but it is, and we can just try to improve and do better.
Sorry, did you say the students take these surveys?
The students do. And again, because it's a testing.
I'm sure they're not reading.
It's confidentiality, too.
They're just going through them. And
right.
Like,
I think in elementary school, they take them at school.
Yes.
I think it's
yes.
done here at school.
In high school,
so
they do it, too.
Yes, they do it here, too.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, they do it.
So it's
not
but I'm sure they're just, like, clicking through.
Right.
Yeah.
I just want to say that's probably why your math tank
because they stop teaching them, they stop having to memorize stuff, and then when they get in those tests, they freeze, and basic multiplication and all that stuff, if you don't use it, and
Well, and also, when you take the algebra test, you have to use the equation editor. And so those are tools that are on the computer that, you know, all your tools are there. You have to do like drag and drop, you have to use the tools there on the computer to do it. And if you don't do them regularly, it sometimes that can skew your answers as well.
If you're very used to a cell phone or a touch screen, having to use a mouse and a computer, you know, can be kind of difficult.
Mm-hmm.
And my son doesn't even know where the phone is with the call.
Yeah.
No, right. They're so used to everything being programmed
right.
and done for them.
Yeah.
Right.
Trust me.
Nowadays, you try to spell rock and you put RIT, it's confusing for you. So they don't even learn how to spell anymore.
Mm-hmm.
They look everything up on their phone.
Mm-hmm. The Google later.
Yeah, all the spell correct, all the check.
Mm-hmm.
But what I did, so to answer is, you know, I need to address this. How are we going to improve? And the first thing that we did was we looked at the master schedule. So we didn't get the data till later. It was later in the summer. And then, of course, we are bound to, we're not allowed to release it until it's publicly released and so forth. But at that point, when we had an idea, is I started to move some teachers around. Like some teachers who, you know, they like to teach, like for math, they like to teach geometry or calculus or algebra 2, they have a strand of math that they prefer. And what I did was I took two of our outstanding, we have a very good math department, very, very good. I'll put them up against any high school in this county. And I took a couple of our teachers who are just, they have such strong fidelity to the curriculum. They're relentless in making sure that students succeed. I gave them a couple sections of Algebra 1, okay? So I made sure that I had certified teachers in Algebra 1. So I'm hoping that will help improve. Just, you know, the fact that we have like two or three additional sections will help improve the Algebra 1 scores. We had a new teacher last year in English, and his scores were phenomenal. Mr. Gray, they were just outstanding. And so now it's a different group of kids. He could do the exact same thing, but it's a different group of students, and you could get different results. Even, you know, so we don't know, because it's like apples and oranges every year.
And do all the students take the same test?
Yes.
So the seniors are taking algebra?
Well, the algebra is taken by ninth graders.
Oh.
And we have students, now we have to remember that students who are in advanced math took Algebra 1 in middle school. So they're not part of this. So these are students who were in general math in middle school. They're the ones that where this data comes from. And you have two choices. If you are in general math in middle school in eighth grade, then you either are going to be in Algebra 1 or you're going to be in foundations, which means you're going to have two periods of algebra. The first semester, for math. So
if they're in the general math population to begin with, they're not your strongest math students.
Correct.
Right.
They're,
in.
The
they're not the ones coming
them.
In.
Mm-hmm.
So,
right.
And
yeah.
some algebra
right.
is just very hard for people to grasp, period.
Yeah, the concept is hard.
Right.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
your more advanced math students got the scores for the Algebra 1 for the middle school.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
So now, because they're in the other.
Right, but it is what it is. We own it. We own our data, and we move forward. And like I said, we look at staffing. We make a plan. So now we have benchmark assessments that we look at, and that's what we can do at this point. Any questions about our star ratings? Okay. The next item is student ID badge implementation, and as you all know, you should have received a communication from me this summer that students would be required to wear badges, and it didn't get off initially in the schools because there were many complications with a system. It was getting the badges for ninth graders. There are laws about transferring pictures. When you have a portal, like you come from middle school and through LifeTouch, which is our, you know, who we contract with, there are laws about transferring student IDs, even if it's within a school system. So we all the high schools had to wait till we had picture day. And then the school system didn't want, ours was one of the first ones to have picture day, but they didn't want us to start in a school that was having picture day a month later, they wanted it all to launch at the same time. So we were given that window of that first week of November that we had to launch, everybody had to launch it that week. I will tell you that it's a struggle every day. So prior, a couple weeks prior to the holidays, I was actually doing something. Miss Alvarez accompanied me, and you've heard of Where's Waldo? You know where Waldo is? I called it Where's Perella, okay? And I actually, what do our students respond to? They love snacks, they love to eat. Okay, they love to eat cookies, candy, chip, whatever. So I had gotten from Sam's Club these little cookies, Oreo cookie things or whatever, and just each day I went to a different area of the building at a different time, you know? One day it could be third period here, the next day could be seventh period there, whatever. And I would bring 25, the first 25 kids that would have their badges on, they got a cookie. Well, they started looking for me. Or they didn't have their badge on, they would walk, then they'd try to find it. what I'm wearing. Some of them have it, and they have it hanging in their pocket. But the rule is that it has to be worn around the neck. And it's for their safety. They don't have to wear the lanyard we gave them. They can wear their own lanyard, but they've got to have their badge around their neck. So it's becoming problematic because they just assume, I don't have that, I don't want to, you know, but in first period, you have to have one first period. So if they don't have it, then they get a sticky badge. And now we're just going through sticky badges after sticky badges after sticky badges. And then they'll get the sticky badge and they'll put it on their leg. And then after second period, third period, they don't have it. So, you know, we're trying to brainstorm as a school how to, you know, create that culture where they own where safety is important, and that the badge is just not for security, which it's part of it, but that this is going to be with as they, if they go to college or work, you need to, if you get on a base, you need to have it. If you go to college, this is going to get you into your dorm. It's going to get you your meals on campus. It's going to, you know, be your bookstore, you know, whatever. It's going to be everything. And so that's what we're trying to emphasize. But, you know, you'll see my messages on the Friday Focus. I'm always putting a little something in there because it is a bit of a struggle. I would say that out of 100%, I would say that 50,
yeah.
55.
And it really depends on the day.
Yes.
There are some days that everybody, where I look, everybody has their badge on. And then there are other days that it's
large pockets that I
Yeah. It because we have second chance breakfast and we have different lines. I'm usually up here and I have a clipboard with the sticky badges. And if you don't have your badge, we make you get it before you get breakfast. And there are some days where I write two out, and then there are some days where I write out 2.5 pages of them.
Right.
So it's very spotty and hit or miss.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Are they supposed to have it on at all times in
yes.
the building, even like in evening sports
activities? No, it's during the school
like
day.
Just during the school
mm-hmm.
day.
School day.
Okay.
Just during school
and
day.
And do they need them when they walk into the building?
They're supposed to put them on when they come in the building, yes.
Because I know in the middle school, my son said they're allowed to keep them in their lockers when they leave for the day, so
okay.
they have them there
okay.
when they come in.
Mm-hmm. Well, you see with high school, there's so many that drive and,
yeah.
and
mm-hmm.
so forth.
I was going to say, I just see Charisse grab the lanyard with the keys
mm-hmm.
and go out the door, so I don't know if she's putting
well,
it on or not. I'll have to ask. Is she wearing hers?
I think she's
in my key club.
Yes.
And so I actually took them to key club one of the cookies, and I think she got a cookie because she had hers on or whatever. But, I know on Monday I did an formal observation of a teacher, and I went in that room, and I all but one had a badge on, and the young lady saw me in there, and she asked the teacher, can I go get my badge? Because she saw me in there. And then yesterday I did a formal observation, totally different content, different teacher, and there was like 4 that had them on out of 18 students. So like I said, it can be hit or miss.
Mm-hmm. I know I'm from a different orientation, so when I speak with you, it's all private. Where I'm from is either you do this or you don't do it. If the school says this is what it's going to be, that's what it's going to be. Knowing that, you know you got to do this because it's going to keep you safe. No, you don't have to know why. You don't wear your badge, but you don't wear it. But my point, what I'm trying to do, this is a different setting, so I was trying to dominate this setting that the parents need to get involved in helping the school do that. Meaning, if my child didn't wear a badge on campus, you give the parents a on some student, I don't know about other students, but I know my child, wouldn't wanna come home to me asking her, why is it that the teacher have called me that you were worried about? My child doesn't want that.
We wish all parents were like you.
No, my child wouldn't want that, because one time, I think there was a situation where the school called, I think it was just an automated call, that she missed her class, which of course she didn't, because I came on campus and verified, and said, oh, Tracy didn't miss her class. But when I called, she was like freaking, no, they, I didn't miss my class. And, you know, because I think the students, when the parents start asking questions, the students will be concerned as well. But if the student doesn't wear their badges on campus, and the school says something about it, and then they go home, there's no repercussion, they still continue doing that, because there's no repercussion here and there.
Correct.
But
and I agree with you, and the code of conduct says, or the superintendent's rule wants us that, you know, you don't have a badge, and that we follow the discipline matrix, meaning after, like, you don't have your badge after 3 or 4 times, then it starts the referral process and so forth. And the teachers have been honest in saying that they're kind of overwhelmed because, and you know, we speak very honestly here, cell phones are a problem here, okay? Students arriving to school, that's a problem here. And I'm not sure, because you are an exception, okay? Or you all that are here this evening are an exception. And Ms. Alvarez can attest, I'll give the example this morning. You know, the code of conduct is about dress code, all right? You know, you're not supposed to wear leggings, okay? If you wear leggings, your shirt is supposed to be fingertip length. In other words, your body should not be form-fitting to the leggings and stuff like that. Or the holes in the jeans. Again, the holes have to be below the fingertips. So no hoods, that's another struggle that we have. Mm-hmm. So this morning, you know, a young lady came in, a 2-hour delay, and she had holes up to her private area, okay?
Wow.
And Ms. Alvarez was actually the first one to see it, because she and I stand out front every morning. And she said, you know, oh, honey, we always address it. We can't come up with your name like that, honey, you know, whatever. You know, you're at a dress code or whatever, and I'll bring them in and I'll say, what grade? The girl did not give me the correct grade level. So I asked her, and I'm very gentle, very, you know, I said, honey, I said, you know that you cannot have the holes like that. I said, that's very, not appropriate for school. I said, but, you know, have a seat here. I'm going to call your vice principal or whatever, and, you know, she'll talk to you about this. And like the first time, it's supposed to be, you know, you'll spend your day in ISR unless your parent brings you up new clothing and so forth. So the vice principal, I go back out on buses, and I just said, have a seat, you know, she'll be here, I called on the radio. I go back out to buses, and then I come, the vice principal goes, well, where's the young lady? I'm like, she's sitting in the main office. She goes, no, she's not, she got up and left. Okay, so then I have to spend 30 minutes on the cameras tracking where did the person go, so, and so forth. And that's the kind of, that's what we are seeing an increase of, more and more of the younger students coming in from the middle schools, like, I don't have to answer to anyone. I can basically do what I want to do. And I'm not saying that's all. A lot of our students do the right thing. A lot of our students do a very good job, but it is becoming increasingly more difficult. And at that, and a lot of our teachers and administrators and everyone, at some point, you have to prioritize, you know, the phone calls that you make. I have made more phone calls this year to parents than I have probably my entire time here at Lackey, and we're up to January. But it's about things like, you help me with this? Can you help me with the badge? Can you help me with the dress code? And really, the parents don't know, because they leave to go to work. So they don't know what they're wearing to school or what they're doing. And, you know, or they could pretend they're wearing something and change, you know. And that's really a home issue. That's, and, you know, it's difficult to change that.
But it's sad, because you have to deal with it here.
Right.
And it takes up so much of instructional time as a teacher, because you have other things you need to prioritize.
No, that's what it is. It's basically, there's that. I was listening to WHA. on a radio show, I said, man, most of our happiness starts from home. Because I wouldn't allow my daughter, you know, some teenage girls, they get mature bodies. So I'm a man. I would be sitting here and see a girl pass by, like, oh, she looks nice. Okay, and I just mean that little girl looks nice, period, right? And then a person might see it differently.
Mm-hmm.
Differently. So I wouldn't want my little girl dressed up in a way to attract the predators or to attract or verifiers. I wouldn't want to do that.
Mm-hmm.
I want to dress appropriately as a teenager.
Like you.
When you get to a point where you can you know yourself as a child, then you understand what to wear, what not to wear. But at that age, it's the parents' responsibility to start telling you what to wear. So sometimes the culture here makes things difficult for some of us that came from different places. When people say, oh, no, she has to make her own decision and she has to make mistakes. No, everybody's going to make mistakes. We still make mistakes as adults, as parents.
Right.
But it's our responsibility to make sure that the children don't make the mistakes that we see.
Mm-hmm.
But sometimes we walk them into it and think that it's going to help. No, it doesn't help that way. So dress codes and stuff, if you start wearing certain clothes from a certain age, the child is going to feel different when they put on certain things. Like if a child got used to wearing jeans and t-shirt, it's probably going to be difficult to get them to wear dress because that's what the parent needed to wear. But if you start making them to wear bikinis or whatever in Liberia, excuse my French, we used to call it dig my ass, like you wear clothes where physically your cheeks is out,
mm-hmm.
when they start wearing that at the age of 11, 7, 8, 9, 10, they're probably going to be walking in the street naked by the time they turn 18.
Mm-hmm.
At that point, now you can't control that anymore.
Mm-hmm, right.
And that's when, like you said, they would, in front of the parent, they're going to pack that. They're going to put their jeans on the bed, put a nice shirt. Oh, what are you wearing for school today? Yes, as soon as the parent hit the door, it grabs something else.
Mm-hmm.
So I think, like you said, I think you guys should put more emphasis on the parents getting involved with the dress code versus you guys doing it because you can't do nothing about it.
Well, you know, I send out the Friday Focus every Friday, and I usually have little blurbs in there about dress code, and I do it very politely. You know, this is a friendly reminder. You know, I state it that way. The last one, I sent something about the parking and ensuring the safety of our students. I sent that last Friday, correct? Friday Focus?
Every Friday.
Did you see it about the parking and about please do not drive in the bus loading zone? I cannot tell you the number of cars. And so I see the number of cars and I go up and I've gotten to the point where I'm out there directing and things, and I'm like, did you get my Friday Focus? and one lady's like, I did, but I didn't read that. I saw it, but I didn't read that, I'll be honest.
I'm honest to you. This meeting, I'm not on your email list.
This is the first one I've read about, to be honest.
My wife is.
It's on the Friday Focus.
Yeah, but this one I think came out separately, and that's why I actually
I sent it through the PTSO. I went in and put in everybody's email because it seems like people aren't reading the Friday Focus.
I read it, but then it's like one of many dates on there, but this I did notice.
Yeah,
it.
And that's why this tonight, before I left, I sent out an email directly to everybody on my list from the PTSO email, which I don't ever use because I have so many emails. I use the board one because I work for the board, and I couldn't send it through my board one. So I went in and I put in everybody's address and sent out a reminder because I wanted to get people here because I wanted to talk about the officers because we really need to get people to step up.
Mm-hmm.
It's like our first meeting, you get 10, 15 people come, and then after that, nobody. It's like ghost.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they like come to find out what it's about, and then they ghost you. It's like, okay, that I can't do that. So it's like... So that's why I sent the reminder out to everybody just to see if we could get more people to come. And I sent it right today so they knew it's today. We also have four athletic events going on right now. We have three basketball games, triple header, and a swim meet. And the gym is packed.
And the parking lot.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The gym is packed for athletics.
And you know what I thought? I thought it was parents that parked the car.
No. That's for events. See, that's the thing. Sports gets all the attention, and it's sad. It's good for the kids, but if your kids aren't in sports, that's why the parking lot's packed. It's for sports.
If there were no sports,
and Boosters has all the
cars
money. They have thousands of dollars in their account for all kinds of stuff. So, and I know they want our spirit wear. They're waiting for us. They're waiting for us to fall apart so they can take the spirit wear. They want to take over spirit wear. So if we don't get people to continue next year, they're going to take it over, and you won't get it back once they take it over.
Mm-hmm.
So, because I started it when Kathy and I, Kathy, I became vice president 3 years ago. I've been the president for the last, this is my fourth year. And I started this whole thing here, the whole spirit wear, not PTSO, but the whole spirit wear thing. I brought it to the school, because I'm from an elementary school, so I see what our school's done. I've been in the school system 28 years, so I know what elementary did. So I was like, okay, I can do this at the high school level, just with little tweaks here and there. And we've done well, and people thanked us. I mean, we've had alumni come back and say, we never had this when we were here. Thank you for having stuff for us to purchase, you know. And thank you for having this and that. And we've brought a lot of different things in. We brought hats, beanies, you know. We have cozies for, you know, just different things. Like, thank you so much. And I'm just like, I hate to see it go by the wayside. I'm nervous, but I can't stay, so.
Mm-hmm.
And I really would, I hate to say it, I really would like to phase out towards the end of this year so I can enjoy the last month of my daughter's senior year and be able to, you know, participate and stuff with her and not have to do all of this as
well. And Miss Adams has been the PAC representative since middle school.
I've been the PAC representative for 23
years.
Yeah,
I know, but with me, I mean, we go back since middle school. So
I've been doing it since Mount Hope.
Yeah.
Let my oldest child
does
it.
I do it for the middle school.
Oh, you'll, okay. Reminders after reminders, and oh, you gotta go to the meeting.
I am going to be honest, this was the first one, the last fall meeting. I missed it. I got my dates mixed up in my head, and I was
I'll forward you my notes for
Miss Willett already sent me on the list.
Miss
Willett,
she's
and
very
I was
good,
like,
yeah.
I missed it.
Mm-hmm. Is there anything from the meeting that was important that we need to discuss at this meeting?
They had representatives from like different.
Did they
work on person? There was a grading person. Someone talked about like the Fresh Start program that's going to be started. It might have already started by now. And then there's one more thing I can't remember. But
changed the format of the PAC.
Okay.
Ms. Holstein.
Mm-hmm.
Because before it used to be kind of topics and hot button issues, and we bring up and, you know, represent. Now it's more or less like a form of stuff they want us to spread. They're using us to spread the good word or spread the news of new initiatives or new things.
Mm-hmm.
And they use us as test groups, maybe.
Yeah. And that's what they did. They broke up into four
mm-hmm.
different groups. And those, they said those were the four hot topics for this school year, at least, from what they've been hearing.
Right.
That, though that might have changed due to like some of the recent things that have been happening. But
cool.
So that's some of the stuff they talked about. And I was, and what they did was each parent went to one of the sessions. They didn't really get too much detail on the other three topics.
Okay.
So I happened to sit in on the grading, so I heard a lot about that.
Okay.
Good.
So they break you up, and then they break you down into groups, and then they combine it together, and then they take the information they got from us and go off and formulate their stuff with it, and
mm-hmm.
they're gone. I know one time I did get to say how proud we were of our school and the administrators and the staff, and I made sure to say how dedicated y'all were and all that stuff. That was last year's meeting, I think, when they had us writing down good stuff or whatever, and they were supposed to take it back to the principal thing, so I hope y'all heard.
Well, thank you.
You're welcome. I know, you're always here. But,
yeah.
Whatever.
But, and, you know,
they
so
were talking about this issue with the parents, uh-huh. and a lot of it starting at a younger age if the parents are more involved
mm-hmm.
instead.
Taken a sign and put PTSO meeting and gone to the gym.
Yeah.
Everybody thinks it's like work, like they think it's a job, and it is work, but it's also benefits so much. I mean, it's not too hard. Everybody thinks it's too terribly
well,
hard.
Well, as
it
gets older, it's not as hard, but in elementary, they're usually doing
oh,
more work.
Elementary
so
is a lot harder.
Like,
they put on fall festivals and like how they do so much. With the high school, you have so many different organizations and groups here doing things. It's kind of hard to find a niche. And like I said, you know, we do a lot of other stuff, but fundraising is part of it because we help fund things for the school and that too. So that's, and it's hard to find things that you can do that everybody else isn't doing because you're competing against drama, you're competing against boosters, you're competing against key club, you're competing against all, in elementary, you're not, you're the only thing selling anything, so all the money coming in is going to that group, and then they can put on things for the kids, like magic shows, and, you know, they can buy different things for the schools, and like, I know our PTO brought a whole laptop cart for the teachers to just share, and, you know, different things like that, so it just depends on what the school needs, so that's a part of it, but, and it is giving back in a way, I mean, we try to give back in a different way, so.
And then the last thing that you see there on that paper report that you have about post-assessment testing, students took at the beginning of the year a pre-test in their courses, and come February, they're gonna be taking the post-assessment. So that's used to measure growth. So what you need to keep in mind is that the scores that they receive will be worth 10% of their third quarter grade. And if it's a semesterized class, like Fit for Life or Health or something like that, then they will already have had theirs. And all the other ones will be in February. And then the two things I wanted to add would be that there was a request from the counseling center. Mr. Caputi is the counseling department chair, and he's put in a request if the PTSO would vote for funding for awards and certificates that they use, and his request is for like $500, and I know that in the past you've done part of it or whatever,
mm-hmm.
or whatever you have, but he's asked me to put that. I have the yellow form in my office. I told him I would wait till this meeting to see what you all could do with that. And then with PBIS, we have a little bit of a conundrum here, is that we have faithfully for the past 4 years, and the intention was this year as well, is that we reward our students for grades, attendance, and behavior. And we have always given them donut rewards from, and we get our donuts from Shoppers Food Warehouse.
Oh.
Okay. So we had actually planned our first quarter PBIS event. We give them drinks and donuts or whatever. They come into the cafeteria, do a little thank you for doing, you know, the, you know, you're doing a great job, keep up the good work kind of thing. They get their donut, whatever. They do it for a period. And they like those donuts, those colossal big donuts from Shoppers. Well, it came out that Shoppers was closing. So we had our date set, and our date for our event was the day, that the last day that Shoppers was gonna be open. I went to Shoppers, and I don't live that far from there, and I'm like, any chance? They're like, well, we only have the batter or the dough or whatever to make, you know, a minimal amount of donuts. And we normally get like 40 dozen or 30 some dozen donuts that we get. So they couldn't fill the order, and their last day was the day of our event. There was no way that they could do it. They told me, of course, that McKay's is buying them. They're going to be located in that store. They do not know if McKay's will continue with how the bakery is currently run, because Shoppers was a union store and McKay's is non-union. So I don't know. They might, because they do have the equipment. They said there's a possibility. So we've been exploring like Safeway, Krispy Kreme, but Krispy Kreme and even Dunkin' Donut were so outrageously priced.
Did you check with Lidl? Lidl has big donuts in there, I saw when I went into Lidl.
No, I haven't been in there yet, because I heard that just opened.
They're the parent or the sister store to Aldi,
okay,
which is
right.
Very reasonably priced. But what was the pricing on this, did you see?
I can't remember, but they were really big. When I walked in, I looked over at the donuts, and Sharice was like, oh, they look good. I said, yeah, they do.
Mm-hmm.
It reminded me of Shoppers donuts.
Okay, all right.
So
the thing is the pricing. Shoppers had a really low price.
They did.
But
more.
I think Lidl, most of Lidl stuff was very low.
Okay.
The other things I bought were very cheap.
Okay.
So I would say,
all right, I'll look into
I was comparing them to the Warehouse Club. You know,
right.
If I buy two of this, I get the same amount. The Warehouse Club, the prices were pretty close.
Mm-hmm.
Or sometimes even cheaper.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know if that's because they just opened, but swing in the Lidl right over beside BJ's and
mm-hmm.
check in there, because they had some really big donuts.
I can check out the school for you.
Okay, so that would be great, thank you, because we're going to be doing probably a combined first and second quarter kind of thing. But I couldn't believe Dunkin' Donut was like outrageous.
Mm-hmm.
and for a dozen of them, it's $8.
The Krispy Kreme is $13. Krispy Kreme is $13-something.
They won't, they, even if it's for a school, they won't give you a break. How about if you buy, get their fundraising ones? They like, they won't give you a break to get the fundraising ones?
They're still kind of expensive.
Yeah, and it's.
Fundraising is usually like $10 a dozen.
I don't think the kids really want that. I could get them probably better from Safeway. But, so just to let you know that that, so that's another reason why we were going around giving out cookies and stuff, you know, during that timeframe was, but, you know, when we combine for this semester, we'll do some extra things because of, you know. So if you all do wanna contribute, if you all wanna take a vote on that as well tonight, I'd appreciate that.
Yeah, or for the.
Yeah, a PBIS incentive, yes.
So how much do you need for PBIS too?
Probably, normally you would give what, $2 or $2.50?
Yeah.
I was gonna see maybe about $300.
Okay.
Because we wanna do some extra things because of what happened with shoppers.
Okay, so we'll just, $6.70, that's $800. Well, so it takes about $1,200 out of our account, that brings us down to $3,000. I mean, I don't have a problem with it, just like the next quarter, we just have to try to make some of that money back up. So we have it for,
A staff appreciation?
Yeah. I don't wanna drain the account down to nothing before I.
No, no, I don't want. So right now, we were looking at, the request would be, a few hundred dollars for the counseling department for various awards.
We'll do $2.50, we'll do half.
$2.50. Okay.
We'll do that, and then we'll do all of your PBIS.
If you wanna take a vote on it.
Okay, so we're gonna do half for Mr. Caputi, Ms. Perlo will cover the other half, correct? Okay, so two.
I seconded. All those in favor?
In favor, okay, so that'll cover that. And then, okay, $300 for Ms. Perlo for the PBIS. I second it. Who's gonna, who vote on that? All in favor?
Alright, okay. Buy one, get one, I was looking up stuff already. $0.69 a donut, and then have $1.49 maple dozens, a dozen of maple donuts are $1.49. And then buy one, get one, 50% off, $0.69 each. See, these are all like Shoppers donuts.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, they really like, you know how Shoppers had the big, they had the sprinkles, and they had all that kind of stuff.
They're really big, so. The glossy. Yeah, they have sprinkles on these.
And they used to,
Sprinkles.
Do they have about a dozen there?
Yeah, they do, jelly filled is $0.79 each, let me see. Buy one, get one, 50% off, this is, and it's giving me the Culpeper store because it's going across the river here.
Right. I just, I wonder, I don't know if they can do our volume, we'd have to see if they can do that. Cause I go pick them up in my SUV and load them and bring them here, you know, and stuff like that.
See, they have the maple ones by the dozen.
I don't know if the kids would like that.
No.
Yeah.
They won't do that.
They want sprinkles and stuff.
They want chocolate covered with sprinkles and stuff.
They had, even have vanilla iced with sprinkles, I don't do chocolate.
They like the vanilla ice too, we usually kinda split it up.
Did you get that?
They have them $0.69 a piece, and then they have to buy one, get one, 50%.
But you see, I buy them by the dozen.
Yeah, they're cheaper, they were like $6 a dozen or something.
Right, I have to buy it by the dozen because I need, normally I get, like I said, 37 to 40 dozen donut.
Well, if you can't get donuts cheap enough, you might have to switch to cookies.
Or unless we have to, I'll have to bring in the student leaders and ask them what they want.
One year they did want Rita's ice.
Yes.
We did Rita's ice.
We did. Kim might give you a good deal. But more towards the spring, you know.
Yeah, Kim might work with you on that.
Yeah, cause at those prices, that still ends up being about, no, that's not a, that, that's for two donuts, $1 for two donuts, so yeah, that ends up being like $6 a dozen.
That would be good.
That's about right.
Yeah.
That's what Shoppers was.
Mm-hmm, $6 a dozen, so that's not bad, $6 or $7 a dozen, so.
Safeway did accommodate us, we had a order for some, a function that we had with student aides and things like that, and they were able to do like 7 or 8 dozen for us at one point, and they did a decent job. They did. That's what I have.
Okay.
Yeah.
meeting adjourned.